I'm hoping at this point you're saying to yourself, gee, that's great. Now I understand why I have to breathe all the time. It's because my cells need ATP energy, and the oxygen goes into getting all the energy out of the food molecules that my body is processing. I also have to get rid of all that CO2 that my cells have left over after oxygen degrades the food. But as I mentioned before at the end of the previous video, we've only covered half of what goes on inside the mitochondrion. The other half is even more spectacularly cool, if you can believe that. And it's basically about how the mitochondrion drives ATP synthesis by using an electrical gradient. That's right, just like a battery. Every mitochondrion in your body is like a rechargeable battery that powers the phosphorylation of ADP, which is the same thing as making ATP. A little bit of the mitochondrial battery's electrical potential is used every time an ATP forms, while simultaneously that electrical potential is being recharged from the energy that we talked about previously, the energy that we get from the oxygens pecking away at the food fragments that are coming into the mitochondrion from the cytosol. It works like this. The Krebs cycle works together with another set of proteins called the electron transport chain, and these are in the inner membrane of the mitochondrion. Hydrogen ions, shown here as H+, get hauled out of the inner part of the mitochondrion and stuffed into the space in between the inner and outer membranes. You notice how mitochondria are always drawn showing two membranes? Well, we actually call those the inner membrane and the outer membrane. Now, the movement of all these positively charged hydrogen ions from the inner space into the space between the membranes is enough to create a pretty significant voltage across the mitochondria's inner membrane. Voltage here refers to the difference in the overall charge between the two sides of the membrane. The mitochondrion's inner area, called the inner matrix, if you want to use the proper term, is quite negative compared with a pretty strong positive charge that we have in the space between the two membranes, and we'll call that the intermembrane space. This charge difference is compounded with a chemical gradient because of the higher and lower concentration of hydrogen ions. And this combination of a chemical and an electrical gradient represents a large amount of potential energy. Notice how the mitochondrial inner membrane is the boundary that separates the two sides of this double gradient. On one side, you have the inner matrix with a low concentration of hydrogen ions and a negative charge, while on the other side, you have the intermembrane space with its positive charge and high concentration of hydrogen ions. This is our cellular battery, in a literal and completely non-metaphorical sense. But keep in mind that we can't really use a literal battery to meet our cells' energy needs. This might work if our cells were cheap electronic doodads from overseas markets, but they're not. Our cells need energy in the form of ATP. Well, in the inner mitochondrial membrane, there's this fabulously complex protein called ATP synthase that first attaches to ADP and a phosphate. Then it allows a tiny bit of the mitochondrial battery's electrical potential to discharge, and then it uses the current, or amperage, that results to reorganize the bond so that now we have ATP. Now realize that there's a lot of ATP that's forming at any given time through this process. Remember the calculation where there's an average of 10 million molecules of ATP used per cell every second. And this on its own would result in the mitochondrial batteries going dead very quickly once all the energy potential got used by the ATP synthase as it cranks out ATP. Well, this doesn't ever really happen because there's a continual recharging of the mitochondrion's electrical potential by the activity of the Krebs cycle in the electron transport chain, and these processes depend on a steady inflow of pyruvic acids and oxygen. Now, the textbook will likely be giving you some kind of bottom-line analysis for the aerobic metabolism of glucose, in which you'd be keeping track of this many ATPs forming here and here, and another big wad of ATPs forming over here, but we're not going to bother with that kind of approach. I would actually prefer for you to carry away a mental image of the mitochondrion as the sort of battery that's constantly subject to two continual forces. First, there's a draining of the battery's energy by the production of ATP by ATP synthase. We just talked about that. And second, there's a recharging of the battery's electrical potential from the energy released as oxygen pecks away at all the energy contained in the parts of glucose that get in from the cytosol. That was the subject of our previous video. If you ever get around to taking a higher level biology class, I'm sure you'll get around to the stepwise analysis of these fueling reactions. For now, though, we'll leave things here and start talking about ways in which these metabolic processes have direct relevance to our lives as non-biologists.